cultural and musical revolution.
The main feeling for me is it's not sort of pain or anything, it's just numbness, you know. You still can't really believe it, the truth.
I think that in general people have a sentimental admiration for him. They were certainly shocked at the manner of his death. And I think most people would like to see him commemorated. Most people want to think well of John.
He was a tough nut with a soft center.
He was a difficult person because he was moody, and you could never be quite sure what mood you would find him in. I would find him early in the morning, as it were, so I know his early morning moods and his late night moods. It depended upon what he was taking, you see.
Everything was very black and white for John. And sometimes, I mean, he would make mistakes and he would change his mind, but at the time he believed in anything, he would believe in it wholeheartedly.
I mean, he had that ability to be gentle and soft and was lovely, but he was, you know, he was acid too. I mean, that he gave that hard edge to the Beatles.
I just didn't want to see, I could see vividly in my mind what was happening, like, by reading the papers, and I didn't want to get into the gory details. I was just in total shock at that point.
I was beginning to understand him a lot more, and the father-son relationship was building better than it ever had before.
Didn't understand a thing. What about the night he cried? Because there wasn't reason left to keep it all inside.
Being sold to the public. But if my old buddy John were here today, he'd be the first to tell you that the Beatles were no saints. The Beatles had traveled a long, crazy road from Liverpool nightclubs to worldwide success. And John's powerful imagination and personality led them along every step of the way. Yeah, for if anybody was really truly born to rock it was outspoken young John Lennon. And to the public, he'll always be remembered as one of the most colorful, charismatic figures ever. But to those near and dear to him, like his son Julian, other Beatles, his record producer, or even his school headmaster, he was something quite different. And that's why, better than anyone else, they know answers to questions like, what was John Lennon really like? And what was it like growing up and going to school in rock's early days? And what was it like to be a Beatle? So for the next hour, you and I are going to be sharing something very special. An intimate portrait of one of rock's greatest heroes, told in the recollections of folks who knew and really loved him. And oh, special thanks to this program's interviewer, Mr. John Torv, who scoured the globe collecting these remembrances of John Lennon. Former Beatle Paul McCartney now remembers John Lennon.
Is it still painful to talk about John?
Yeah, I mean, it's a little while since. The main feeling for me is it's not sort of pain or anything, it's just numbness, you know. You still can't really believe it, the truth.
Yeah.
Still sort of feel like he's sort of there somewhere. It was just such a crazy thing, you know. I think I felt like everyone felt, really, just, oh God, you know, it's that kind of irrational thing that you can't almost think anything about. You go between total anger and really sort of just wanting to, I don't know, yeah, but just to have some violent reaction to thinking, well, what can you do about all that? You know, I think it's very much our modern society kind of, I think there's a lot of that happening.
When did you find out John had died?
Just early in the morning. But I sat down one day and was just strumming along, and that was the sort of idea that occurred to me, was like that if John was here today, and I was saying, oh yes, I knew him well, he was a terrific guy and stuff, he'd be saying, oh, you know, a load of rubbish. It was in his character. So that's sort of what the song's about. It says, and if I said I really knew you well, what would your answer be? Well, knowing you, you'd probably laugh and say that we were worlds apart and so on, this kind of thing. And then it says, if you were here today, and it's about that.
Do you think there's a difference between music that is around now and music that was around then?
I hope
In the 50s. Yeah. But a difference in that, like, there seemed to be a rawness about, you know, a simplicity and a rawness then that doesn't sort of exist today. And there seems to be a little melody in new wave music.
Yeah.
And yet in the 50s there was great melodies still associated with that.
Yeah, but you know, the thing is, then people were saying there's no melodies in this rock and roll. Every record sounds the same, which is what they're now saying about reggae. You know, every record sounds the same. All they say about New Wave, everything sounds the same. But I think to the fans of it, they don't sound the same. Like to us rock and roll fans, you could have never persuaded me Chuck Berry was anything like Bill Haley or Little Richard. But, you know, analysts tend to sort of group it all together and sort of say, I think it's pretty good music today. I think the big difference probably is just the technological thing. That when they were making those records, it was just, it was a straight performance. They didn't do much in overdubs. Well, nowadays, I mean, you can record, like, what, 92 tracks, if you want.
Yeah.
And that makes a difference, don't you? The sound in the end.
Of course, it
becomes
it was,
very much more kind of precise.
It was largely the Beatles that pioneered that multi-dubbing to rock technique. Sgt. Pepper's is commonly regarded as a breakthrough album.
He said dropping his notes. As bad as Michael Parkinson. Yeah, I suppose we did. We got it off somebody else, of course. Like all our great innovative stuff, people would say, wow, the haircuts, you know, and all that. We always used to say, well, we were really only just part of it. We ended up being the spokesman for it and probably the most visible ones out front there, so people thought, well, it's all us doing it. But actually, there were millions of art students at the time who had their hair like that. And in the double-tracking stuff and the multi-track stuff, I think originally we got that off It's My Party by Leslie Gore. That was one of the first double-track records I ever heard. And we just went to our engineers and said, you know that record? We'd like to sound like that. And we started with that. And of course, went over the top, as usual.
How did you and John write songs? Did you actually write songs separately or together, or was it a combination of both?
It was a combination of both. Sometimes, when we first started off writing, when we were kids, we used to just sit down with two guitars, like this, just and strum sort of at each other, and sing anything. And if an idea came out, just develop it up into a song. If he had a line that I didn't like, or I had a line he didn't like, we'd just tell each other, say, I don't like that, and we'd just do that. That was one way we used to do it. That's the kind of joint compositions way. And then sometimes, like with something like Yesterday, I just had the tune and the words, and I would just have that whole song, and I'd bring it to him and kind of say, you know, how's this? And I played it to them in the studio, the group, and they said, well, you don't need an awful lot on that. You know, I said, well, okay.
Yeah.
And then sometimes it'd be like Strawberry Fields and sort of ones that were more John's, like Help would be John's idea. Hard Day's Night was his idea originally. And sometimes he'd just write them. In other words, the answer is there wasn't any formula. We did them every which way.
An orphan, John was raised by his loving aunt. Growing up a confused, sad, angry young man during his school years, John's teachers thought he would never amount to a hill of beans, all except one, Headmaster Popjoy. Mr. Popjoy remembers John Lennon.
What were your impressions of him? Can you recall those for us?
He was very talented. He's made his name, of course, in pop music, but he wrote poetry, he designed posters, he painted, he was very keen on salmon fishing, had many interests, and he was good at many things.
What was his scholastic record like?
He narrowly failed in every subject he took in external examinations, but that was merely because he attached no importance to passing. I think it rankled with him a little in later years from one or two things he said, but he is certainly a very intelligent boy who could have passed with ease if he'd wanted to.
There's no suggestion from what I see around the school here that it's a working class school, and yet John seemed to have working class values.
I would have said that is a myth, that John had a lower middle class upbringing, if you must put a label on John. I think it's been convenient for some people to describe him as working class, but no, I don't think so. There are many working class children here, but we have the normal distribution in the state school, that is to say, a school where fees aren't paid.
And you were responsible for getting John into art school, as he suggested.
Well, I discussed with John and with his aunt what he should do, and I had a word with the principal of the art college, who didn't later on thank me for it, and he did go to art college, and that's what he was referring to in his letter.
But you saw something in him that...
Oh, he had great talents. It didn't take any great perceptiveness to realise that.
Is there any resentment about the Beatles in Liverpool?
Some party politicians reproach him for having left Liverpool and not having returned.
And that's...
They opposed the raising of a fund to build a statue or the naming of streets after him.
Would you say that's a widely held attitude?
Not widely, no.
What would you think Liverpool's attitude was?
I think, in general, people have a sentimental admiration for him. They were certainly shocked at the manner of his death. And I think most people would like to see him commemorated. Most people want to think well of John. John has told the truth about his life in his writings. He's given an unvarnished account. I don't think people want to hear him criticized. I think they would want to be proud of him.
I love you. Little huckster and promoter jumped into the Liverpool music scene by taking notice of brash young John Lennon. William arranged an audition with Lennon's band, Johnny and the Moondogs, for a tour of England. Instead, the band was booked for a tour of Scotland, during which they almost starved to death. But nevertheless, thanks to Alan Williams, their first agent, later known as the man who gave the Beatles away, they were on the road. Alan Williams remembers John Lennon.
Alan Williams, you have the distinction of being the man who gave the Beatles away. Alan, could you tell us how that came about?
Well, it looks like I'm stuck with it till the grave. my son said to me, just going off the track for a minute, Dad, he's 16, he said, I hope I'm not going to be known as the son of the man who gave the Beatles away. That's how worried the family are about this tag of mine.
John Lennon started the Beatles.
Oh, yes, yeah, there's no doubt about it. Paul was a very late member of the group, even in the Quarry days. We've reached the stage of me calling these boys who used to play truant coffee bar layabouts, because they would sit all day on one cup of coffee. And I was having trouble with the public health authorities because of the obscene graffiti in the ladies' toilets. Because also, where groups will go, there'll always be groupies, girls who follow the groups. And they used to write obscene comments about certain parts of the body of the groups and the toilets. Now, I shared my toilets in the daytime with the local shop next door to me, which was a news agent, which had middle-aged ladies serving, and they complained about the state of the toilets. So I was issued with an ultimatum. Either I close the club or, you know, clean up my toilets. So knowing that these lads, two of them were from the arts college, I thought, well, if they can paint art, they must be able to paint, you know, with a brush. So I asked them, would they care to paint the ladies' toilets? And of which they said, yes, how much? John, of course, how much? So I paid them £10, and they redecorated. That was the first contact I made with them. And by the way, they made a marvellous job of the toilets. It so confused the public health authority that he wanted to close me for the psychedelic sort of paintings that they did on the wall.
Was Liverpool a tough area at that time?
Oh, yes, yeah. It was, it's always been known for its violence. And
give me an example of violence. What do you mean by violence?
Well, everywhere they played, it would finish up in a fight. In actual fact, one place that I sent him to play, over the water, even in 1960, there was a lad beaten up and booted to death at the very dance that they were playing in Heswell.
Well, it's been some time now since John Lennon's life ended near his home in the Dakota Apartments in New York City. December 8th, 1980 was a day that marked the end of an era and all hope of reuniting the Beatles, the band that John had forged into the hottest act in rock and roll history. It was permanently laid to rest. The Beatles legend will live forever, and because of that, the myth of the cute choir boy mop tops is still being sold to the public. But if my old buddy John were here today, he'd be the first to tell you that the Beatles were no saints. The Beatles had traveled. traveled a long, crazy road from Liverpool nightclubs to worldwide success.
It started, I was 17 when I first went. We went to Hamburg and we were given a job in the Reeperbahn, which is the naughtiest part of Hamburg. Mm-hmm. And they booked us for 8 hours a night, and then the club we were in had to close down. The police shut it down, so they moved us into another club where there was another band also booked for 8 hours. Mm-hmm. So instead of giving us 4 hours each, we started at 2 p.m, did an hour, and they did an hour, and we did an hour, and we went right through. Second week of doing that, around about the sixth set, when we were flagging a bit, and the boss of the club, who was a bit of a gangster, brought all his gangster pals in, saying, you know, wanted us to jump up and down. Preludin, which were women's slimming pills. And we'd take them and froth at the mouth and leap up and down, singing, what I say? Don was like very tough. I mean, he had that ability to be gentle and soft and was lovely, but he was, you know, he was acid too. I mean, that he gave that hard edge to the Beatles, you know, a sort of an orphink. As Popeye would say, he was an orphan, you know. His father left home, and you know, like, you've heard the songs, Mother, you left me, but I didn't leave you.
Well, there you have it, the days in the life of rock's greatest, John Lennon. And if he could hear me now, I certainly let him know that his contribution will never die. But for right now, we can all say, John Lennon, remember.
I love you. Didn't understand the thing, but we could always sing. What about the night we cried?